We're here today to have an interview with Sidney W. Benson, an emeritus professor of chemistry from the University of Southern California. My understanding is that Sidney was born in New York City. He went to a well-known science high school there, and perhaps he might tell us just briefly when we get to him something about his experiences there, because I think it had a significant influence on him. He went from there to Columbia University and was an undergraduate there, received his bachelor's degree, and from Columbia University went to Harvard University and studied with a very well-known chemist there by the name of Kistiakowsky. He worked on the Manhattan Project during the war and finally received an offer from the University of Southern California. I think at that time the head of the chemistry department was another well-known emeritus professor here, Anton Berg. My understanding is that Anton made him an offer that Sidney didn't really feel was sufficient, so he said, thank you, but no thank you unless you can improve it. The university did, and then Sidney joined the university first in, I think it was 1943. Mm-hmm. He spent a period of time here at the university and left USC in, I believe it was 1963, to join the Stanford Research Institute in Palo Alto. After a period of 12 years there, returned to the University of Southern California and has been here since. So I would like to welcome Sidney, who is our interviewee today, and then ask him to perhaps begin by talking about his first experiences as he came here. Sidney?
Thank you, Ken. Just let me say in regard to Stuyvesant High School, at the time, this was before the institution of the Bronx High School of Science. Stuyvesant High School was the unique science high school in New York City. Entrance was limited by the space available. It was a very tiny school. It was by competitive examination. It was a marvelous place to get an overall background in science. The principal and most of the faculty were dedicated to teachers, and they had wonderful facilities which they threw open to the student body in the afternoon through a club system. So if you belonged to the chemistry club, you had free run of the laboratory facilities in chemistry, and similarly in physics and other subjects.
Well, I know it had a significant influence on you. I also know that you as a child had a chemistry set at home that you used to play with. Many of us did. What were the chemistry facilities like at USC when you arrived here, the laboratory facilities and the size of the chemistry department?
When I came here, I was the seventh member of the chemistry department. There were actually six of us who were members of the chemistry department, and the other one, Professor Smith, Snuffy Smith, we used to call him, was in the School of Pharmacology, but he taught one of the freshman courses with me. The facilities here were very few and very primitive. We had no machine shop. We had no glass shop. Anything that we expected to do, we either built ourselves or did outside. They had one or two lathes that were available on a part-time basis, and that was it. On the other hand, this was the end of 1943. We were in the middle of a war, and USC was not a research university in any sense of the word, but they had aspirations and dreams and hopes, and that's, I think, really why I was hired.
So when you began here in 43, you found an institution that was much more of a teaching institution that had hopes of becoming a research institution.
Yes. Yes, what people, I think, may not appreciate today is that USC started as a collection, as a small college and a collection of professional schools. It was very much community-oriented in that it felt it had a very practical job to do, namely to turn out teachers, dentists, doctors, lawyers, ministers for the local community, which it did in great abundance and very successfully. So it was a working institution. And the other thing that is remarkably different from what it is today is that it was a commuter institution. It had no dormitories and no campus facilities except for what's called Fraternity Row up on Adams. and didn't have as many fraternities then, at least in terms of numbers of students, as it has now. Very few students lived around campus, and most of them either drove or commuted into the school. The result was the school died at about 5 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. What were some of the major problems then that that were to be overcome as the institution, university, tried to change itself, tried to become a major research institution?
Had a terrible problem in two terms. One was in terms of attracting good faculty, good younger people, without adequate facilities. And the second one was trying to develop resources which might attract them. So it's essentially done what it did from the beginning of time. It created schools and it created colleges on a shoestring, brought in one or two people, hopefully, with the idea that they might get support from somewhere and that the thing might grow. But you have to give you a contrast with the situation today and then. Today we have some 28,000 students equivalent, graduate and undergraduate in professional school. At that time, the total was 6,000. More interesting was the total faculty numbered only 350 people. And within 4 months after I had been here, I knew every one of them personally. And about 50 or 60 of us would always have lunch together in what was once the bookstore, which is now being remodeled.
You said that when you came here, you were the sixth faculty member. I had mentioned Anton Berg was the head of the department then. Who were some of the other faculty that you found here during your early years that people might know?
The people I was immediately closest to were the people in physics and mathematics and biochemistry. Another thing which has changed historically, when I came, chemistry and biochemistry were a single department.
They were a combined department.
Combined department with one chairman and a sub-chairman who operated biochemistry. That was Harry Duell. But we used to have joint faculty meetings every now and then. Mm-hmm. And that was only after the medical school moved up to its present location that biochemistry separated from chemistry. And it was done not on the basis of interest, it was done on the basis of the fact that the medical school would pay them better. So we lost biochemistry at that point. But the people in physics who were interesting at the time were Richard Volrath, who was the head of physics and had quite a reputation nationally for work he had done when he was at Caltech and Johns Hopkins. Anton was, of course, at that time fairly well known even then for his work on boron chemistry, because there were only about three people in the country who knew anything about boron chemistry, and Anton probably was the top one among them, Schlesinger of Chicago being the other one. And people in that we brought in very quickly who did tremendous amount in developing the department since were people like Arthur Adamson and Jim Wharf, Wayne Wilmoth, Jerry Burson, Jerry Donahue, and I'm talking now a period that goes from about 1946 roughly to about 1952, and Dave Dowes. The other one who really, without whose help, I don't think any of this would have been possible, was Albert Ropenheimer, the dean. He was a real personality. SC, when I came, even though it had very few faculty, it was rich in personalities. Ropenheimer was one of them. He was dean of the college then. And I think it was his ambition to raise the level of the university to a research status. He was the one who brought in Berg. And Roby wasn't always the most diplomatic person in the world, but he knew where he wanted to go, and his values were basically sound.
There were some other incidents, I think, that occurred while you were a young faculty member here. I recall hearing a story about the faculty pay issue that came up fairly soon after you arrived. Can you tell us the story about that?
Yes. This, I think, was one of the most significant episodes in USC history, because it came at a very crucial time. USC total budget in about 1945 was something like $1.5 million a year. Faculty salaries were, during the war, probably low. within 6 months after the end of the war, they became outrageously low because of the rapid increase in prices after the war. Dr. von Kleinschmidt, who was the president of the university and who guided it during its most important formative years of the 20s, I think had very little appreciation for how the average faculty lived or responded economically to the scene in Los Angeles. Give you an example, the top salary, and I'm talking now about a full professor in medical school with 15 years of history at USC, turned out to be $4,000. My own salary was not too far from that, and the bottom salary was about $1,900. And that was a full professor who'd been a full professor of classics for over 20 years. I kind of like to meet people, and so moving around faculty tables at lunch, meeting people and talking to them individually, I soon became aware within a year or two of my coming here of the critical situation in regard to faculty salaries. It wasn't that the university couldn't afford to have larger salaries, but I think von Kleinschmidt was in a mental rut. And he didn't have a large bureaucracy at the time. He had one registrar, and he had one controller, and nothing was spent without his personal signature. Actually, it was his secretary, Ada English, who signed all the requisitions. Anything she was dubious about, she would either throw away, or if she really had second thoughts about it, she might pass it on to von Kleinschmidt. But frequently, you put in a requisition for something that you needed, like red crayons to grade exams, and nothing happened. And so you put in a second requisition a month later, and you might get the requisition approved. You had no way of knowing me well what was happening. And so he ran that. It was very much of a patriarchal system. And I think he felt he knew what was good for the school and what was good for the faculty.
It was his school.
It was his school. And in large measure, it was his school. But then when the war ended, and this, he had a faculty meeting, and that was his mistake. Because he announced at the meeting how wonderfully we'd done during the war. We were essentially round the clock, round the year, school year, three semesters. We were still on the semester system. Three full semesters every year. And he informed us that after having worked so hard and now facing bulging enrollments and insufficient classrooms, we were going to have to be asked to pull in our belts and work even harder. And lo and behold, at this faculty meeting, which was very well attended, I think 300 out of the 350 faculty must have been there. Fred Wiersing, a professor from the School of Education, got up practically sputtering. And he was one of the old timers. And he said, "President von Kleinschmidt, how dare you ask us to pull in our belts when we've been starving, literally, for the last 5 years?" He said, "Why don't you say something about sharing some of the huge funding that's coming in from this large student enrollment with some of our hardworking faculty?" There was a stunned silence for a minute, and a few of us started applauding and swept the whole theater. That was too much for von Kleinschmidt. He adjourned the meeting. But it inspired a group of us to bring together a conspiratorial group who immediately proceeded to lay plans to foment a rebellion. And we did. We organized a group of faculty under the aegis of the American Association of University Professors, since there was a group on campus. I don't think the national organization had any idea what we were about. It had been principally formed back in the hundreds, early part of the century, to protect civil rights and constitutional rights of faculty, freedom of speech, and things like that. We were acting, we decided, really as a labor union. What happened initially was we had a meeting with von Kleinschmidt. Well, we first formed a steering committee, and this is where my knowledge of the faculty helped immensely, because I knew the colorful personalities, and so I picked them. Clayton Karras for the School of Commerce, and who was an old friend of von Kleinschmidt. Frank Baxter, who was a remarkable speaker and wonderful personality from the English department, was a secretary. Clayton was the chairman of the American Association of University Professor group that we formed spontaneously.
Yes.
And then Sidney Duncan from engineering, I think that we needed wide representation. And then Carlton Rodet from the history department. And I was apparently the statistician because I could figure out from the numbers of students and the statistics that were published what the university budget was. And apparently I came very close. I found that out 2 years later when the vice president in charge of finances corroborated all of my calculations. We proceeded to hold a faculty meeting, which was incredibly well attended. And for the first time, I think we faculty appreciated how many grievances there were and how many people felt rather strongly about these issues. And we voted at that time to allow me to do something unprecedented, which was to take a personal poll of people's salaries and years of service at USC. And I was sworn to secrecy. Only I would have would see those ballots. And I did it, and for the first time, I was able to find out the accurate salary picture. That we had something like 90% return on that poll. So armed with those figures, we were in a very strong position to say that faculty salaries could be raised 10, 20% actually, without university even noticing in terms of its total budget. So that was a very reasonable demand.
And those demands then were met by the university?
Well, the initial response from von Kleinschmidt was he gave us immediately a 10% raise. Totally ignored the fact that we existed or we were pressing for other demands as well, initially. And that was kind of a stalemate. He was very upset personally. At one point, Clayton Karras walked into him and he started crying on Clayton's shoulder. He said, "How could you do this to me, my own faculty? How could they turn on me?" And Clayton reported this to us, and he was rather touched himself. And he said he just didn't understand the depth of the feeling or the fact that times were changing, and indeed had changed. And I think nothing would have come of this. We had finally, in the spring, another meeting with von Kleinschmidt, and it was quite clear that he had hardened his position, didn't want to hear anything more about the American Association of University Professors. But something turned up at that point that changed the whole picture in a very dramatic fashion. The school had been had just received a search committee from the State Board of Education in regard to its certification as an approved school. Mm-hmm. And in responding to that, they had to say what the teaching hours were, what the student-teacher ratio was, and what the faculty salaries were. And this was signed by the president of the university, and they turned that over to the state. And we got a copy of that. And we had our own personal poll on the faculty salaries, and the salaries that he reported were some 20% higher than the one that had been reported to the state. And this created a scandal which hit the Los Angeles Times and Time magazine. Yeah. And embarrassed the university trustees no end. They ace a call, particularly sensitive to this kind of thing. So for the first time, we were invited to meet with the board. And we presented the entire story. I think they would have cheerfully cut our throats if there was any proper way of doing that. But instead, the next thing that happened was that von Kleinschmidt agreed to step down and become chancellor of the university, and they started a search for a new president. They immediately hired a financial vice president to serve as an interim officer for the university while they were looking for a new president. This was Bob Fisher. And he was someone that we could really talk to for the first time and had a better appreciation of what the realities economically were. And then von Kleinschmidt himself announced the faculty senate as a great step forward in faculty administration relations.
Maybe you would like to talk a little bit about some of the people that have had a major impact on the development of your career at USC and development of the chemistry department at USC.
Well, I think once we had picked up the younger people that we picked up during the late 40s and early 50s, we really had a remarkable group of people. In fact, Arthur Adamson, a few years ago, made a survey of the publications per faculty and research funding per faculty. And we were among the first three in the country in chemistry departments at that time. As he says, we've gone downhill since then.
Well, there wasn't much room to go up. That's
no, there wasn't. There wasn't, since we had really a remarkably young group, and all interest, all with major dedications in the research areas. But they include people like Jerry Donahue, who was chairman of the department at one time, just before I went to SRI. Bob Bold, who was also acted as chairman of the department, and Dave Dowes, who was chairman later on.
Sort of in view of all that, what prompted you to leave USC in the early 60s to go to the Stanford Research Institute?
That was purely a personal decision. It had nothing to do with my work or USC or my desire actually to stay at USC. Since the year before it happened, I had just finished designing a new research lab in the new wing of the building.
Maybe the
stapler. That was just being built. No, what happened was my wife, after a bad pregnancy, became very ill, and then it turned out she was allergic to Los Angeles smog, ironically. And we spent about 2 or 3 months one summer just traveling around the state trying to find out a place where the air was a little more tolerable. And we found out the only place that, in California at least, was San Francisco. And that's really why we moved.
Then you returned to the university again in 1976 or thereabouts. How much difference was the university at this time than when you had left it? Had there been substantial changes in that 12 or 13 year period?
There's been incredible changes, otherwise I never would have thought of coming back. I left in 63, and 58 Norman Topping came. And Norman Topping, in my opinion, was the man who's really responsible for what I would call a modern USC. He literally turned the place around. He had a genuine appreciation for faculty, for research, for what a university might be, and how to go about fashioning a university. He understood, for example, that nothing was possible without resources. And he set about developing resources and putting USC in a position where it could begin seriously to consider fundraising on a large scale, which it never had done successfully before. I saw the result of that 12 years later when I was asked to come back for an interview. And the campus had more than doubled in size. The facilities were incomparably better than the ones I had left. Although I should add parenthetically, immediately after the war, we didn't have any buildings. We had all of these students. And the only way we could resolve that problem was to borrow 20 barracks from the Department of Defense. And they were kind enough to give us those barracks. And barracks were a large part of USC life immediately after the war. My laboratories were in barracks. Some of our classes were in barracks. All the freshman chemistry labs were in barracks. Despite the barracks atmosphere and facilities, some of my best work was done in those barracks. And I can say this now because I'm no longer dependent on the facilities or the development and facility for the work I'm doing. I certainly enjoy the facilities we have in the Hydrocarbon Research Institute, which are among the most modern in the world. But I can't knock the barracks.
You mentioned the Loker Hydrocarbon Research Institute. Shortly after you returned here, the Loker Hydrocarbon Research Institute was established, and you are now on the scientific directorship of that. You're a co-director, is that correct?
Yes.
What is the Loker Hydrocarbon Research Institute, and how has that benefited you and the university in recent time?
Well, at the time I came back in 1976, the country was in the middle of an energy crisis. I had just received the award of the American Chemical Society for petroleum chemistry. And many of my interests were in the field of energy and combustion and related areas. A year later, we succeeded in in hiring George Olah, who had 3 years earlier received the award in petroleum chemistry. And Jerry Siegel, who was then chairman of the department, had a brilliant idea. He said, "My God, we're starting a fundraising campaign." That was the Century 2 campaign. And he said, "We're the only institution in the world that has two winners of the Petroleum Chemistry Award. He said, how about forming an institute? And we thought that was a great idea. And it particularly appealed to George Olah because he didn't relish moving into the old science building, which was what he had been forced to do. And so this is an interesting story because it's characteristic of what USC could do in 1977, which I don't think it could do today. Within 3 weeks after Jerry Siegel had the idea for forming a Hydrocarbon Research Institute, and George and I had given it some substance, and we had a third possible member for it, he presented it to Caprilian, who was then research director and vice president. And Caprilian thought it was a great idea and convinced the board that it was a wonderful idea, and it had been approved by a committee of the board.
In three weeks.
And that was a commitment on the part of the university for $2.5 million to build a building. Fortunately, they were able to raise funds from the Lokers, who were looking at various projects in the university that might be interesting to them. And they decided energy was one of them. And so after the university had already designed the building, they came up with a substantial gift toward its completion. And it's been a wonderful institution ever since. We've managed to establish it as a worldwide institution with worldwide recognition, so that when people come here, they're amazed at how small it really is.
That was an unusual decision for a young PhD from Harvard to make in 1943 to come to the University of Southern California. Would you change that decision, or would you change any of the other sorts of decisions you've made about your career at USC?
People are constantly asking, would you do this, that, or the other thing differently in your life, particularly when about half of the things you've done have been disasters. But I've decided philosophically that that's what makes a life. If you make decisions and you do things, you're going to make mistakes. It's called learning.
Yes.
And the only way you're going to avoid those is if you don't do anything. No, I don't regret coming to USC. I think it's been a great experience. I certainly enjoyed it, and I wouldn't do it differently.
Another thing I did not mention at the beginning of our interview, Sid, was your family. I understand that you have one son, and your wife, Anna, has three children also, and you have two grandchildren. Are any of those Trojans, or do they expect to become Trojans in the future?
My son got his PhD in molecular biology just 2 years ago at USC. Yes, and he's now at the University of Utah doing research work. And my son-in-law got his MBA at USC about 15 years ago and is making very good use of it now in Italy.
Sidney, I know you've had a number of accomplishments during your long career at USC. Which of those accomplishments have given you the most satisfaction?
I believe the one that I'm proudest of is my election to the National Academy of Sciences on the basis of work that was done at USC. The other achievement has been in the last 10 years work at the Hydrocarbon Research Institute in the development of patents, two of which look like they will bring back appreciable sums of money to the university.
Your election to the National Academy of Sciences, there have been relatively few members elected from the USC faculty.
Yes, and this is one of the hallmarks, let's say, of a major research university, the number of people that it has as members of the National Academy. In the past, there has been only one member who was elected to the National Academy on the basis of work done at USC, and this was way back in the wartime period, Paul Guilford, work he done in the psychology department. on human perceptions and development in terms of the instruments for and perception of instruments and human responses to instrument changes. So I think mine is the second. And it's important because now, if you look at USC, we have members of the Institute of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine. We have over 17 members, which begins to be now a respectable number.
Yes, really.
We should have about three or four times that number.
Sidney, I know that much of your chemistry has been involved in studies of things in the gas phase, things in the atmosphere. How much of this is related to the pollution problems and can be used to address those sorts of problems?
I would say going back to the early discovery of smog in Los Angeles, I've been involved in one way or another in air pollution studies. And I continue to be involved and do work in that area. Los Angeles, of course, has a unique atmospheric situation, but it's rapidly being copied by Denver and, of course, other countries around the world, places like Mexico City, Barcelona, Milan, are beginning to have huge air pollution problems that will eventually limit their growth and limit their development. The work that we're doing now is closely involved with the questions of air pollution and pollutants generally. I say this with another view in mind, and that is chemistry in the last 30 years has gotten a very bad press. People, when they think of chemicals, think of something wicked. What they don't understand is that all life on this planet is the transformations of chemicals in the human body or in some organism, plant, or animal. And if we have problems in connection with that, those problems will only come from the efforts of chemists for solutions to be resolved. This is something that is not widely appreciated by the public, and yet it must be. I think in the same sense that physics might be looked upon as a central science of the 20th century, I think chemistry will become the central science of the 21st century as some of the major developments in biochemistry and molecular biology begin to be pursued.
Some commentators have indicated that they think chemistry's golden period may just be waning, that the excitement of chemistry, which occurred in the 30s and 40s and 50s and 60s, may be over, and that the new excitement is in the area of molecular biology, neuropsychology, those types of areas. What is your view about the future of chemistry and its potential?
No one in pure chemistry expects to see any major new laws developed in the future. In the same sense that thermodynamics has four laws and they're complete, that Newton's laws of motion are complete, that essentially quantum mechanics is a complete science. In the same way we feel that we've explored the basic generalizations that can be made in chemistry. On the other hand, chemistry will play a growing role in areas like biochemistry, material science, neurobiology, and chemists will play a very important role in assisting the chief actors in these areas. And if we just look at some of the inventions and developments in medicine alone, CAT scanning, for example, is basically done by chemists. Lauterbur, who developed the CAT scanning algorithms.
You mentioned about the public perception of chemistry. What can be done to improve the public's perception and understanding of chemistry?
I think this is something that's going to be a long-range problem for science and indeed for politicians. The public has to be educated on what science is and what it does and what chemicals are and what they can do. If you mention something like chlorine, everyone thinks of an evil, toxic gas. On the other hand, sodium chloride is salt, and everyone has salt in their diet, and we couldn't live without salt. People have to understand that some chemicals are harmful. On the other hand, in limited quantities, they're beneficial. Fluoride ion, which is being discussed and has been discussed for a long time, is essential for bone growth and in preventing tooth decay. Too high a concentration of fluorine can be toxic and very dangerous. Every chemical substance is dangerous in large quantities. You can drown in water.
I know you've enjoyed your life as a chemist. You have mentioned before how much you've enjoyed doing research and also your teaching. You're now an emeritus professor, I understand. What are your future plans for your chemistry?
It's interesting that you should ask. I reached a stage in life now where I don't make long-range plans anymore. I pretty much try to enjoy what I do from day to day. And in chemical areas and related areas, that's just what I do. So I'm working on problems that I think are important and to which I think I can contribute. Mm-hmm. I will not work on problems where I feel other people can contribute just as well. I don't see the point in duplicating those efforts. And I'm having fun.
I would like to thank you, Sidney, for joining me for this interview and giving me the opportunity to participate in this and sharing with us your views about the university, your remembrances of the history of the university, and your thoughts about some of the things that we've discussed. Thank you very much.